In studying the short history of the Clonard area, it can be considered to be a microcosm for the wider history of the conflict in Ireland. The 19th century saw Belfast develop into an international hub, owing to the ever-expanding shipbuilding and linen industries, motivating many to seek a better living around the city's many growing factories. The Catholic population grew from a few thousand from the beginning of the 18th century to over 100,000 in little over 100 years. In response to the needs of worshippers, many Catholic churches towered over the sprawling red brick terraced homes built to house the families of linen workers dotted around the city. In October the 4th, 1908, work commenced on the iconic Clonard Monastery, taking 3 years to build at a cost of £32,000. As early as 1899, the demographic nature of Clonard's position to the Protestant Shankill district saw recurring sectarian assaults on the area's inhabitants. In the years leading to partition, the dominant hand of unionism ensured the north of Ireland would not be a safe place for its Catholic population, culminating in the sectarian pogroms between 1920 and 1922, with over 20 people alone murdered within the Clonard area. Murder squads consisting of members of the Crown Forces roamed the streets during curfew, targeting civilians and Republicans alike. Ned Trodden, John McFadden and volunteer Sean Gaynor were their first victims on the 26th of September 1920, with another savage act taking place on the 23rd of April 1921 with the murder of volunteers Dan and Pat Duffin in their Clonard Gardens home. The IRA relentlessly pursued these killers, catching up with and shooting many, including Sergeant Glover and the infamous Sergeant Christy Clark from Springfield Road Barracks. The War of Independence continued, and volunteers from Clonard were sent to County Cavan to form a flying column. During an engagement on the 8th of May 1921 at Lappenduff Mountain, volunteer Sean McCartney was killed and 7 volunteers captured. They were subsequently sentenced to death, but were retrieved by the Truce of July 1921, the year Ireland was partitioned. The Unionists consolidated their new state through sectarianism and violence, and a new state militia, the RUC, was formed, and along with the Loyalist Auxiliary, the B Specials, ruthlessly suppressed nationalists within the 6 counties. A Special Powers Act was passed by the new Protestant Parliament, which gave provision for internment, censorship, and suppression of free assembly, as well as for corporal and capital punishment. Stormont kept nationalists in the position of second-class citizens, with franchise restrictions and discrimination in jobs and housing. However, Republicans remained defiant and continued to challenge the state. In Easter 1942, the IRA in Belfast wanted to commemorate the Easter 1916 Rising, and so a group of volunteers under the command of Tom Williams were tasked with creating a diversionary operation so that a parade could take place in another part of the city. Their intention was to fire a number of shots over an RUC patrol car at the junction of Cashmere Road and Clonard Gardens. However, the volunteers were quickly surrounded by the RUC in a house in Conpore Street, and a gun battle ensued, culminating in the death of an RUC man and the arrests of Tom and his comrades. Tom, while lying in hospital, believing he was dying, accepted responsibility for the RUC man's death. However, all 6 volunteers were sentenced to death. After a massive campaign, Henry Cordner, John Oliver, Patrick Simpson, Joe Cahill and Jimmy Parry were reprieved.
The 6 of them were sentenced to death, and then there was a terrible hue and cry throughout the country for to have them reprieved. And everybody, you know, was working on that, you know, the Republican movement were working on it, the Cardinal Dalton was onto it, De Valera was onto it, there was people contacting the Americans were onto it, there was thousands upon thousands of signatures lodged with the Northern Ireland Home Office here, and everybody was hoping that there would be a reprieve. But we didn't know it. On the Sunday before the 2nd of September, the six of them were brought together, and the solicitor told them that five of them had been reprieved, but Tom was to pay the penalty. And Tom immediately, the fellas kind of broke down. They couldn't accept that they were going to be let off and Tom was going to die. But Tom said that this was the way he wanted it. He told them, he said, "I've prayed for this," he said, "and this is the way I want it." And he was glad that they were being reprieved, but that he was going to die. Well, when we heard the news that Tom was left to die and the others were reprieved, that we were just numb. We couldn't react to it at all. You just couldn't believe that that had happened, that the situation had changed so much inside so short a time. Within a couple of days, five men were reprieved and the other one was going to die. And we couldn't believe that they would even let that happen. And we were hoping against hope that there would be another reprieve and at the last minute then Tom would get off. But it wasn't to be anyway, and it was very evident that on the Tuesday that Tom was going to die. Father Oliver, who was our chaplain, as I said, he came in a little early and he told us that he had been with the other priests who had attended Tom, and that they had to waken him actually in the cell. He had slept all night and they actually had to waken him for Mass. He talked to us a bit about Tom, and then he went in the vest for Mass. And when he came out onto the altar, he turned round. At that time the priest had his back to him when he was saying the Mass. He turned round on the altar and he said that he had timed the consecration of the Mass for 8 o'clock. And he said that when he held up the Blessed Host, he would be making the sacrifice to God. He said, "You'll know at the exact time I'm doing that, Tom is also making his sacrifice." And that, I would say, was a terrible moment for everybody that was in that part of the prison I was in.
Tom Williams was executed on the 2nd of September 1942 and was buried in an unmarked grave within the Crumlin Road Jail, where he remained until he was finally buried in Milltown Cemetery in January 2000 after a lengthy battle by the National Graves Association. His funeral was attended by thousands. Under great pressure and vastly outnumbered, the IRA fought on, and many volunteers were imprisoned or died at the hands of the enemy. Volunteer Gerard O'Callaghan was murdered by the RUC on the 31st of August 1942 at Bodor, Hannistown. He was preparing weapons to be used in an offensive in the wake of the news of Tom's execution. Volunteer Seamus Rocky Burns escaped from Derry Jail in March 1943 and continued on the run, becoming a much-wanted escapee before his death at the hands of the RUC on the 12th of February 1944. Resistance soon fizzled out, and the Union estate seemed unshakable. Despite this, the IRA remained, albeit as a smaller, less effective organisation. A new campaign was launched along the border in 1956, and many people from the Clonard area, including volunteer Prunches McCart, who remained a committed Republican until his death on the 8th of January 1992, were interned.
I remember going up to the jail with McGronagh and that some years ago. I think it was about near the end of the 56 campaign to visit him in the Crumlin Road jail. So he was arrested then along with a lot of other people. So he was at the end of that campaign and during that campaign. So and then back and forward to jails all my days to him. So it was.
As a person, what was he like?
A very good person and very good for people, you know, that he was close to and other people, so he wanted to do good for people and good for the area as well.
The border campaign was a failure and the IRA leadership entered into a period of internal reassessment, which concluded that armed struggle should be abandoned. This was to cause a split within the movement when Nicelandists' homes were undefended during the unrest of 1969. The civil rights campaign called for an end to discrimination, only to be beaten off the streets by a unionist regime unwilling to concede an inch to the modest demands of those seeking equality. Widespread unrest followed, which eventually erupted in August 1969. The unionist state again resorted to its old tactics of repression and pogrom. Catholic homes had been destroyed in Conway Street and Norfolk Street, and on the 15th of August, an orange mob, backed by gunmen from the UVF and B Specials, tried to invade the cluttered area.
They are supplied with the guns from the B Specials. Were they using guns? They were using guns. We hadn't a gun at all. And we were left holding a baby all the time for to fight ourselves. No defence of any kind except stones and what we had, not what we could find in the streets.
Working up at Anderson, and the boss came round about 2 o'clock and he told me, "You'd better go home." He said, "There's trouble on that road you live on, Cashmere Road." And I came home and I came down to the bottom of the Cashmere and there was a trailer across and there was stone throwing going on between us and them. They had a barricade across it at the bottom and we had a trailer across at the corner of Bombay Street and Cashmere Road. And we were standing behind it, throwing stones down at them. And it was a small man, I won't mention no names, and he had a hammer and he was breaking up the flags into small pieces for us to throw at them. After about an hour, it settled down, and I walked up Bombay Street to look for my daughter. And the first thing I knew, I was lying on my back on the ground. I'd been shot in the back. And then four fellas came out of Cooper Street and came up round the corner and shot me twice, once in the chest and in the stomach.
Fionn Gerald McCauley was killed. He was the first Republican activist to be killed in the current phase of the struggle.
As he really started off in St John's Street on Collamore Street, and then he went from that to St Thomas's at a certain age. And that the last year he was leaving, he was blamed for doing some damage to hand basins in the toilets. Apparently they were acting a fool, him and a few other lads, but he got the blame of it anyway. And he left school and he got this job in Northumberland Street. And he was in it 3 weeks whenever they asked for me to come down and see him, so I naturally thought he had done something. But the man came out and he said that Gerard was a great worker, a very clean worker, and I said, "Yes, but he needs his hair cut." It was a bit long. And he says, "Nothing to do with his hair." He says, "As I say, this is a family affair." But he says, "He has so much in common with my boys," he says, "with birds, the racing at Dundrawd, fishing, and everything like that." But he says, he tells me he's going to join at a certain age, the Irish Merchant Navy. And I said, "Well, it's the first I know about it." He says, "But the way I brought you down here, I'm sure you're wondering," he says, "is, as I've told you, he's a great worker. And we're all a family affair. We don't take an outsider, but if Gerard comes in, he'd be the first outsider that we'll have." He says, "We have him now on a wee small cutting out machine, the materials. But," he says, "would you be agreeable to him going to tech if he's agreeable," he says, "in September?" And I said, "Yes, I'd be delighted." And everything went well and I left. So then it was the next week that I worked in the CNA then with a neighbour two doors down. And her and I were, we heard on the news that morning Patrick Rooney was shot dead in Lower Falls in the Divis. So it came flat down the stairs just before I was going out. And I said, Jared, there's a wee boy. I says, there's one in Ardoyne. I says, and there's a wee boy, a 9-year-old, has been shot dead by police in the Divis. So that was already went out into the bathroom, came back in, and Mrs. Gray, that I worked with, a neighbour, come up for me. And her and I started to walk up the street, and she remembered she was in her slippers with the annoyance of the news. And she came back down again, and Jared lifted his flesh like that. He was only in, knocked on top, just a pair of corduroy trousers. And he lifted his flesh, and he says, look, Annie, there's a way I'm going to work. So her and I went off to work anyway, and on we came out at 12 o'clock, and we couldn't get a bus or anything. We didn't know how bad things were. And I went away around as far as I was told to go to the bottom of Donegal Street there, that there was buses running from the Springfield there. So there was a girl standing too, and I says, oh, I'm not waiting no end longer. So she asked, could she walk with me? That she lived round the bend in the Springfield. And I said, certainly. So her and I kept walking anyway, and we got to Divis Street, started walking up the falls, and she started to get a bit nervous with me. And she says, I'm a Protestant, she says. I'm a bit nervous walking along. I says, you'd be quite all right. But in saying that, we didn't know how bad things were till we got to the Cooper Street. And there was a bit of going on, and walked on up, and I got to near Colin Ward Street, and it was in, I think it was my gym, I'm not quite sure. Somebody anyway came and told me that Jared was hit with a stone. So when I got down to the house, one of the children, I can't remember which one, said that there had been a reporter there looking a photo of Jared. And I says, why would he want a photo? So the next thing I asked, it was Ben McKenna, a neighbour next door, took me in the car down to the hospital. I pleaded with him to let me in. I says, maybe you don't understand his name. I says, it's Jared McCauley. Just let me in to look around me. But I says, they wouldn't hear tell of it. And those people came in and the blood run out of them. But then I came away from there. And as I came out, the phone box at the top of the, just here, the taxi stop there on past Dundle Park. I run in there because somebody said about the Brits were coming. And when I looked, I could see them in the distance marching up the Grosvenor. So I came from there, I run round into Springfield Avenue, and Mrs. Burns brought me in, and she said that there were the bread and that I have bread in the house, and she gave me two loaves, taken out of the bakery. And it came on the news in her house about a youth of 19 had been shot. And I said to her, I says, that's my girl. She says, God, don't say that. I says, it is. So I came up anyway, and as I came up, the Brits were standing in the street. Of course, I lost a head, and I shouted at them to go to the Schenkel. I come on down, and Jerry Furs came, and he said, everything's all right, it is Gerald. So, I can't remember much after that for a while. But I remember the next morning, somebody came in with the Irish news that about Gerald. And then they were waiting on Gerald being brought home. And a van drew up the door. And all of a sudden the neighbours that was in the house got me out of the way and brought me upstairs. And I heard them saying that he wasn't allowed to be brought upstairs. He had to be kept downstairs and the lid wasn't to come off him. Couldn't take the lid off. I couldn't even see him.
Out of the ashes of Bombay Street arose the Provisionals, who would now defend nationalist areas from Unionist incursions and engage the British establishment wherever it deemed necessary. Republicans were now engaging in an armed struggle, unseen from the years of the Rising, with many men and women now joining the ranks of the IRA. It was while returning from a training camp that volunteer Peter Blake was killed on the 27th of October 1970 after his vehicle was in a collision with a British Army truck near Dungannon. Clonard became the focus of many British Army operations, with numerous raids organised in order to quell the success of C Company, 2nd Battalion.
Abominable, disgusting, disgusting in every way. The obscenities, and come down to see the houses, and the obscenities and everything that they use to the people and the talk of them. There are some good ones, I'll admit, among them, but there are very, very few.
If you come down and see what they've done,
down round this, just down here, down the Springfield Road. But the army during the night, they got their bulldozers and knocked down the barricades. Well, they could knock the barricades down gently, could they not?
But they empty the rubble into the people, and always.
What happened? Don't call me one kid.
Mrs.
I don't know what happened. I mean, no one. But would you take me down the barricades? There's nobody in the house. They all get out. That's all I can tell you. It's just we come home this way, we find our homes.
Internment was introduced, and many young people from Clonard were held without charge. In other parts of Belfast, the British war machine was relentless in the murder of many Irish citizens, including the murder of 11 unarmed civilians in Ballymurphy over a three-day period during internment. 2 days after internment, volunteer Seamus Simpson was to be another victim of the British establishment.
That day he was killed was 2 days after internment, when the barricades were still up. Seamus had just previously married, just 2 months before he died. But he called up to see, he was on his way up to see my mother when he heard there was the trouble was on up at Rosnarine Avenue, off the Shaws Road, Nonnerton's town. And he met my sister Margaret on the street, and he said, "Look, just tell my mother, I'll be back down later on for my dinner." And and off he went. So apparently, from what we can hear from witnesses and people who were actually on the scene, and with no doubt whatsoever, Seamus was there throwing stones, bottles, whatever was going, and resisting the British invasion. When at one stage he took a tricolour in his hand and began waving it, and that's when the British took the decision to execute him, and they shot him, and he fell on the spot. And the snatch squad, the British Army snatch squad, moved in, and there's also evidence there now. We have that he was still alive, but his body was dragged and beaten. And placed in British Army vehicle. Mystery still surrounds with him between he got there and got to the hospital where he was pronounced dead. We were unaware of this for so many hours until a priest called in the house and told my mother that her son was dead and we lost our brother. It was the circumstances we were, and that's how we found out about my brother being killed.
It was hard for me, so it was, because I was only 19 years of age at the time, with no family or nobody about me, you know. But it was one of them things, you had to sort of accept it, because what else could you do? And I came home then again in 1972, just at the time the ceasefire broke on Lennadoon Avenue. I think it was one of the first ceasefires, I'm not sure, where... Well, as I say, I came home then and had to put myself into perspective of what happened and what I was going about to embark on myself. But as I say, Seamus didn't fall into chance by becoming a Republican overnight, because of the way the situation started to pan out here in 1969, the pogroms and stuff like that there. He probably would have got involved anyway, no matter what. But we had a Republican background there, if you want to say. My father, who was sort of pretty active, he was a Republican in the 40s. You know, we had a lot of old 40s men that in them days, right? And also my uncle Pat Simpson was arrested, along with Tom Williams and his other fellow comrades at that in Campo Street, I think it was. There was a shootout. Yeah. There was a cop shot there. And they were all sentenced to death. And we know how that panned out. Tom took full responsibility, and Tom was executed, and the rest of them were commuted to life. But this is the type of background that we had. And stories we used to hear from my father about Campo Street were very intriguing, so they were. Even after the 40s, where the cops used to come around and chase them, it was fascinating how people were playing cards in the street, and a cops came. All the doors were open right down onto the Falls Road, down in three entries. There were never none of them ever caught, only to come back and play cards. Handball was the same on the walls, you know. But we were, I suppose, to myself, the Camporos, the Canary was intriguing in that way. We had all the wee stories from my father, and that would be about mostly my father, you know. But And that's how Seamus was drawn to the Clannery area. He felt that his war was there because of our contact, of our connections with the Clannery area.
On the 7th of January 1972, C Company was to lose another as volunteer Danny O'Neill was killed on active service.
Well, we're starting here today what was the junction of Armour Street and Label Street. We're told by local residents that on that day there was a heavy raiding party of the Gloucester Regiment raiding in the back end of the district on the Cashmere Road, and Label Street would have led directly onto the Cashmere Road. Donny O'Neill, along with a number of our volunteers, we're told, were part of an active service unit which was sent out to engage the British Army raiding party. And they came from the lower end of the district, it's known now as New Clannard, what was known then as the Pool. And as they drove up Clannery Street, they actually drove into the actual raiding party and had to avoid them on a number of occasions and come back round here to try and find the location to mount an ambush. Because of the proximity of local civilians, they couldn't engage the British Army at that stage and decided to abort the operation. But as they were abort the operation, a sergeant came up the Springfield Road travelling countrywards, actually spotted the active service unit they disembarked from the Saracen, and as the car drove off containing Donny and Lee, who was sitting in the back seat, the British Army engaged and fired a shot which hit Donny in the back. Donny at that time was fairly seriously ill, was taken to a local first aid post in the Falls area, received some treatment there by a local doctor. Because of the seriousness of his injuries, he was then taken to the Mater Hospital. We thought the word was within the area that he was making a bit of a recovery, but unfortunately that didn't happen, and he died of his wounds on the 7th of January 1972.
He was a Republican because his whole family were Republicans from way back. So his granddad Leo, he was a Republican, and he was interned in England during the war, things like that, and he just grew up in a Republican family. And his father was a Republican too and was interned many a time, things like that, you know, in the 40s. Montague, Monsignor Montague in St. Paul's, wouldn't let coffins go into the chapel with tricolours over them. You know, he wouldn't let them in at all, and caused a lot of heartbreak over it. And well, when Donny was, his coffin, when they were taking him over for the mass in St. Paul's, his granny and his uncle Robert put the tricolour around him in the coffin. And then when the coffin went over the out the door, they put another one on, and then when they got over to the chapel, it was taken off, and then they went. And months later, when Montague was coming down the road, I think he was stopped by Donny's mother, one of the family, and they told him what they'd done, and he didn't like it. He says, well, you didn't bait us, because he had the tricolour over him, but it was in the coffin of the lawman. You know, and he didn't like it, he won't, but he just shook his head and walked on. You know, he didn't believe in giving them a proper burial, you know. And that was that, you know.
An economic bombing campaign was underway, and volunteers from C Company were heavily involved. On the 9th of March, tragedy again struck when four volunteers were killed in a premature explosion in a house in Clonard Street.
Behind us here, this house with a commemorative plaque is a site where four young volunteers were killed in active service due to a premature explosion on the 9th of March 1972. They were preparing a bomb to go out on a commercial bombing operation when we were off prematurely, killing all four volunteers. And it was actually beside the home of volunteer Donny O'Neill, who was shot dead by the British Army just a couple of months previously to that. It was a devastating blow for the people of Clonard, a small, compact area. To lose four young volunteers at one time on an operation like that, as I said, just devastated the complete Clonard community.
Not only was it devastating from the fact that they were four volunteers from this community, but they were also our friends and comrades who we went to school with and grew up with. It was a double blow for us all.
Whenever they come into Bombay, they had to bomb it and burn the houses down. And at that particular time, I was in the auxiliaries myself, and we just took up to defend the area, especially Clonard Monastery, which was the target, and then St. Gall School and all around that area there. So we're just working class people. The women and all, we all got together, and I think we done well. We did well. I lost my brother John in a bomb explosion in Clonard Street with the three volunteers and himself. Four lovely lads, brilliant fellas everywhere. Good crack, good footballers and the packs and everything like that. Real sportsmen. So them boys there lost out in a big lot. But they fair played them. That's just the way they wanted to go, and there was nothing going to stop them. So premature bomb went off and bang, that was it, and that was it all over.
I'd just left school, and I'd started a job brewing at the Belfast Library. So it was only here a couple of months. And this is the actual day. And it's my recollection, I've never really checked this out again, but it was about 11 o'clock Thursday. Heard an explosion and knew it was very close by, just the sound and the noise. Looked out the window, seen the smoke go up in the air. Sort of stalled for a bit. And then left the job in Madrid, and I was just two streets away from Clarence Street. And sort of walked among the debris, etc., but didn't recognize Gerard. That was it. Sort of, obviously, everyone arrived on the scene. Well, there was people there before I came, but it was sort of scene of devastation, smoke, dust, all of what you see on TV now. And sort of hung about for a while, and eventually it all started to clear up. Went back to work for the rest of the day, and sort of went back to work. We're all talking about it, what we thought had happened, etc. So it wasn't until that night I'm leaving work and walking up Clarence Street. Was obviously closed off, but I got further on up Clarence Street and up and cordoned off, and I met a group of it's sort of personal, but met a group of guys who I knew from Connery and sort of stopped. Well, what happened down there, etc., but they all looked at me in a strange sort of way, and that was me just leaving them thinking they were behaving strange there. Went down to the house, and when I reached the house then, Mom was in a bad way. Asked her what had happened. She told me, I said, it's not true, because I was there. That was it, really. Everybody sort of knows him, you know, it sort of came, dad came in, brothers came in, yeah, it was true, so that was it.
The way I look at it, he was respected in the area. Not just him, the four of them, you know, because the lads, you always seen them about the area. 99.9% of people would have knew them. Maybe didn't know they were in the IRA or anything, but knew them as young lads. And as much as they respected the people of the area, I think the people of the area respected them also. You know, and I always looked up to Tony, and the turning point with Tony, I think, was when Geraldo McCauley was murdered in Bombay Street, Waterville Street, 15th of August, because Tony and Geraldo were very thick. They'd been in the Fianna together before Bombay Street, and I remember that day. And he was banging his head on the wall, no, 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 I can't be Geraldo, I can't be Geraldo. So that was a big influence in Tony too, losing his friend, you know, and maybe made him more determined to become a soldier and fight the war against the Brits, you know. My mother was really bad. And like, we were young then, you know, I was about 14 or something, and Pauline was older than me, you know, it was younger ones. But although it affected us, it affected my mother terrible, you know. Well, obviously any mother lost a son, but then again them circumstances, and Tony being so young, he's only 16, but he would have been 17 on the following month, April, 4th April. So it was a big, big, big shock and big, big loss.
I found out that at that time I was driving for Glass Merchants on the Springfield Road, and I was delivering to Portaferry. When I came over the radio, there was an explosion in Clanner Street. My gut reaction first was it was Tom and the lads. Somehow I just thought Tom had been on somewhere. I phoned McCann's up and they told me, not too much detail over the phone, but just says, I asked him were the lads involved and they said yes. And I says, Tom where? And he says, we don't know yet. Because of the way it was, the body was found and Tom's body wasn't found. So I didn't hear any more information until I got home, where it was confirmed that the three lads were in it, but there was no sign of Tom. And that went on for a while, until one day that the RUC came to the house and said they found body parts. And Tom had a birthmark on his hair, a white streak down the back of his head. And they found a scalp in the remains of the bomb. And would somebody go down and identify the remains? At that time, all the McCann's family dropped out, and Tom Sr. asked me would I go down and identify the part they had found. I went down to the morgue on a Monday, I think it was, with Father Reid, the late Father Reid, at a Clannad monastery, and a detective for the Springfield Barracks. When we got down to the morgue, there was other RUC men there, and they were examining the body of young Tony Lewis. After, well, typical RUC men, after trying to annoy you and saying this is your mates and all, they were informed there was only flesh and blood there, that our lads were away to heaven. Which Father Reid got very annoyed at and grabbed one of the policemen. Tom's scalp was on a tray, which was very easy to go to, but being RUC, they went through every tray until they got it. And that's how Tom was identified. That's all that was left of him. I went back to monastery with Father, and we went to McCann's, told him, as far as I could do, the best of my ability, that the scalp in the morgue was Tom's. And that's basically, was it. McCann's family, they kind of accepted from the start, because you know in the dust again, Sean, the word was out that Tom was there, but you never seen him, you never got a body. And Frances found it very hard, because she was Tom and Frances were very close. And Frances was not accepted, Tom was dead for 25 years. Till the public movement, they done a presentation down City West. It was very good, and presented the families with a trophy, a crystal plaque. And that's when she finally accepted Tom was away. Because every rap the door, she was thinking he was coming in, and it just didn't happen. That's how Tom and the lads went. They were a good bunch of lads. Republicans staying through. And I'm sorry I lost this.
Equally shocking was the brutal murder of Fionn Sean O'Riordan, who was shot dead by the British Army in Cawnpore Street on the 23rd of March 1972.
He was lovely. Loved reading and football and hurling. He was not around athletic. When he was young, he was out in the street playing. I'm trying to think. It's been hard for me talking about him. He would have sat and sang to me. He made up a wee song, and because I'd got my hair dyed, and he made up this wee song, Yellow Haired Woman Will Never Be Mine. He used to put his head on my shoulder and he would sing it to me. He was great with wording. he was just a child that you would have loved. Loved school. Brilliant school. Brains were thrown away. Even when he was a kid, small. He was a great swimmer. He was just somebody you would have loved. You know, the kids were aware too of what was going on, but he was very aware because I was always talking about stuff. My father was, you know, an internee, and then he grew up with me talking and he remembered everything. He was a brilliant kid. He just was an all-round athlete. He was the youngest ever to win the High Dive. So he was. He loved all of his brothers and sisters. And he loved me very much, and I loved him very much.
Apart from the terror of the British Army and the RUC, the people of Clonard had to face the terror of sectarian murder gangs. As a result of one of these random sectarian attacks, volunteer Joe McKenna was killed in May 1973.
I was born 17th of May 1979, and he died on the 17th of May 1973. So immediately there's that sense of like those two dates combining. I mean, 6 years apart of me to be born and be given the name. I suppose growing up, you know, when in the Falls in Belfast in the 80s, like, obviously you're aware of the troubles and what's gone on before, but you're always aware of just a sense of a loss in the family, you know what I mean? Particularly for my father, who lost his older brother, like the next one up, you know? So you're always aware that there's a sense of, you know, there's a sadness, you know what I mean? And sometimes, you know, you come to your birthday and like, you a visit to the cemetery is not normal for your birthday party, you know what I mean? But that would be something that would happen, like, you know, and something I would carry on doing, sort of my younger years. And as you kind of grow up, you kind of realise not only was it a loss to the family, but it was a loss to the Republican cause, a loss to the community, you know, a loss of a person who, you know, whose convictions overruled his fears, you know, and he's someone who stood up for themselves, stood up for the community. You know, and even now as I get older, it's something that I still take a lot of inspiration from, and something that I learn more about, you know. Because, like, having never met Joseph and having only second-hand accounts of what he was like and what he did and, you know, who he was and the life he led, you're piecing things together. But the one mainstay has always been like that he was a committed volunteer and he was a committed Republican. And that's essentially what cost him his life, you know. So although there's sadness, it's also tinged with a lot of pride, knowing that you have this person in your family who was willing to stand up for the community, you know, and that it cost them, you know. So it's a real mixture of, you know, pain and pride, you know, in terms of my relationship to Joseph's memory, you know. So for me, it's not something I tell an awful lot of people about because it's very personal to me, you know, but it is something that I do keep very close to my heart, you know.
In an effort to defeat the Republican struggle, the British employed a new counterinsurgency offensive. They were now going to try and break the IRA from within the prison system by labelling political prisoners as criminals. This was to lead to an epic struggle in which the prisoners refused to break. They wore blankets rather than prison uniforms, unhinged by the policy of criminalisation. One of the first blanket men to be released was volunteer Martin McKenna, who campaigned tirelessly for his comrades.
Martin McKenna was full of life. Everybody loved him, mate. So no matter where he went, he was just so full of fun and carrying on. He just carried on with everybody. He was like a big kid. But he worked really, really hard. He was national organizer for Sinn Féin, and he worked all over the country and worked really, really, really hard. But he was just full of fun. He was a big guy, you know. Everybody loved him. Martin was killed in a car crash. He was on his way home from Dublin. Him and I had been on holiday earlier on in the year, and his car had broke down. We were going from Donegal town to Letterkenny, and the car broke down, middle of the night. I mean, him's trying to thumb a lift. See the amount of people who slowed down and let on, they were stopping and then drove off and laughing out the window. Me and him were like, oh my God. And we got picked up by these two guys who were on their way home from a funeral, who were drunk. And they kept trying to give us drink, and me and him was looking at each other going, headers. But I made him promise me that he would never pass hitchhikers. I said, you know what it's like now, so no matter where you are, because he'd done so much travelling. And when Martin was killed, there was a hitchhiker in the car with him. And I always thought, oh, I wonder, did he tell him our story, you know? But the hitchhiker came away without a mark. Martin was driving, and there was a lorry coming towards him, and another lorry came out to overtake, and it was a head-on collision. And Martin was killed. And we were supposed to go and visit his mother. His mother lived on the Antrim Road, and we were going to visit her because they had won the pools. They had won money, and they were packing up their house. They had bought a new house in Bangor, so their house was all packed up. So we were supposed to go visiting them that evening, and I was waiting on him coming, and our phone rang, and it was his brother-in-law. And I said, no, Tony, he's not home yet. I'm waiting on him coming home because he lived in our house. I'm waiting on him coming home. And he was like, no, you have to listen to what I'm telling you. And I was like, what? He says, the police were here. He says, Martin was killed in a car crash early that day. And I had seen, when I was watching the news earlier on that day, Martin drove this wee lime green mini car. And I had seen one on the TV as I was walking past from the kitchen to go out the hall, and I was like, same as Martin's car. Da-da-da-da-da, away I went. And that was actually Martin's car on the TV, where they just showed the accident. But the hitchhiker walked away with not a mark on him, which was a good thing. But Martin didn't.
Another blow came to the Republican community with the death of stalwart Republican and volunteer Liam Hannaway on the 2nd of February 1981. The prison struggle was coming to a climax, and the only course left open to the prisoners was a hunger strike. Like many other brave men from around the six counties, Clonard man Pat Sheehan joined the protest.
Well, I was captured and around the start of 1978. Was sentenced in March 1979 to 15 years for causing an explosion in the town. That time the blanket was in full swing. I ended up in H4 and, you know, was on the blanket. Never imagined at any stage that I would end up on hunger strike. Although, funny enough, before I ended up in prison, I suppose it would have been 1978, talking to some of the other lads who I would have been working with and saying, I think the only thing that's going to sort this protest out in the prison is a hunger strike. Not in any way thinking that I would be in any way connected to it, although that's how it turned out. But actually, it became more difficult, something that I didn't foresee, when shortly before Bobby went on hunger strike, on the 1st of March, I had a visit with my mother and father and my sister Louise, who was a year older than me. And at the end of the half hour visit, my father sort of stalled back a bit and said, listen, son, I want you to withdraw your name from the hunger strike. He said, Louise has been diagnosed with leukemia and has been given 5 or 6 years to live. So it was right at the end of the visit. There was no time for conversation, no time for questions. And I went back to my cell, basically with my head spinning, devastated at the news. And I had a major decision to make about what I was going to do. And I gave it long thought. But at the end up, I decided I would allow my name to go forward, because I took the view that everyone who was in the H blocks at that time could have had a sad story in their family. And I wasn't going to use that as an excuse not to go on hunger strike. I got a call then from the leadership of the army, and it was addressed to volunteer Pat Sheehan. And sort of paraphrase what it said, was that by embarking on hunger strike, you're bringing the movement into direct confrontation with the enemy. If you have second thoughts at all about that, stand aside now and nothing less will be thought of you. However, if you decide to go ahead, you will be dead within 2 months. So think about this carefully. So yeah, I have to say that rocked me back on my heels. Because first of all, well, when I saw two volunteer Pat Sheehan, I mean, I sort of felt a sense of pride, because I was always proud of being a volunteer in Oakley na Hearn. So, you know, you don't often see volunteer in front of your name, but when I thought about it later, usually the only time you see volunteer in front of anybody's name is on a gravestone or in the obituary columns. So, and then when it went on to say, if you go ahead with this, you'll be dead in 2 months, it was there in black and white in front of you. You know, there was no ifs or maybes, or, you know, we don't know what'll happen, you might be dead. It was quite clear and categorical, you'll be dead in 2 months. So, and it said, you know, if you're not 100% sure, stand aside. Now, was I 100% sure? I can't say that I was. Because when you're going into totally uncharted territory, how do you know? But I was as sure as it could be. And actually, as time went on then, the longer I get into the hunger strike, psychologically, I'd say I became even stronger. The weaker I became physically, the stronger I became psychologically. And there's no doubt in my mind, had the hunger strike continued, I would have died on it. So, but I was very lucky to have survived. The hunger strike ended on Saturday, the 3rd of October. On that Wednesday, I'd been examined by a consultant from the city hospital, who told me that my liver was beginning to shut down. I was totally jaundiced. I was completely yellow. Weighed about 7.5 stone. I was nearly totally blind, and he said to me that my liver was shutting down, and he couldn't guarantee, even if I ended my hunger strike there and then, that I would survive, because there was a possibility of irreparable damage having been done to my liver. And this was in the days predating liver transplants. I mean, even if they had considered giving me one. So, but as fate had it, the hunger strike then, it was decided that the hunger strike would end on the Saturday following that, a few days later. I was taken from the prison hospital to Musgrave Park, and I made probably the quickest recovery of everyone who survived the hunger strike and had no long-term damage as a result of it. None that I'm aware of, anyway.
The hunger strike of 1981 was a great loss to the Republican family, with the deaths of 10 young men. Willing to lay down their lives for a future free from discrimination and the terror imposed by Britain. Still, the IRA could not be defeated, a fact the British were willing to concede themselves. On the 25th of June 1986, volunteer Brian Dipper Dempsey was killed in a road traffic accident in County Tyrone while on army business. A dedicated volunteer, Brian's death was later followed by the killing of volunteer Jim McKernan on the 14th of September. He was killed in active service, shot dead by the Royal Marines on the Andersonstown Road. Another tragic loss came to the Clonard area with news of the death of volunteer Finbar McKenna on the 2nd of May 1987, as he attempted to launch a grenade attack on Springfield Road Barracks.
Well, he was
could be, because I'm the youngest, so he was a bit protective. He could be funny. He could start around an empty house. He can be Karen. He was always a joker. Devastated the family, tore the whole family apart. My daddy died the following year. He was heartbroken. Just disbelief, something that got over to this day.
His funeral cortege was later attacked by the RUC as it entered the Falls Road from Cavendish Street, with many mourners receiving savage beatings. The war was extended on all fronts, and the audacity of IRA operations was unrelenting, with the culmination of the attempted assassination of Margaret Thatcher in Brighton in 1984. These daring attacks continued, and on the 6th of March 1988, Clonard suffered another blow with the execution of volunteers Dan McCann and Sean Savage, who were killed along with their comrade Mairead Farrell in Gibraltar.
They were committed, determined Irish Republicans. They were people who wanted to make the change that was necessary in this country. They were people who didn't talk about revolution. They were people who made it. Every one of them in their own right, was a Republican leader. I think that the logic, if there is a logic behind what Britain does in Ireland, was that they thought that Gibraltar was a knockout punch. They thought that by murdering those people with that caliber of commitment, that it would be a fatal blow to the Republican struggle. I don't think it was coincidence. I don't think that it was somebody acting impetuously. I think it was a decision taken at the highest level. I mentioned earlier that Gibraltar was a military camp, and I mentioned that to set the scene for what happened, not least of all, because there was never, ever, ever any possibility of any escape. A second into Gibraltar and they were captured. They were never not captured. They were never lost sight of. They were never evasive. They were captured. So the decision to carry out summary execution, I believe, was, from a British point of view, was to be the death blow to the Republican struggle.
The strange thing he said to me, too, he said to me, will you lend me a car? He says, and I was sitting there, and he came in, he said, will you lend me a car? And it was just for a minute or two. He says, I go on ahead. I threw the keys at him, and he went out. And a minute, it was hardly 2 minutes, getting the key and the car and all and away. But he came back again. And he says, hey, you are. Thanks very much, Danny. I thought it's funny. Like, he got it such a short time. And like, he couldn't have went anywhere. He could have got down to the corner and out of the car and back in again and up again. I think, like, I'm thinking this, maybe I'm all wrong, but I'm thinking that he more or less was just a way of saying, you know, bye bye and thank God for you, or something like that.
Sometimes it's very vivid in my mind. Sometimes I just try and think of him as a kid. But the abuse that was given during the period of his remains coming home and up to the time of his burial, the abuse that the British Army done and the RUC it's very hard to forget. There's an old saying, forgive and forget, but it's very hard to forget. He was a great lad. He was very helpful. He was dedicated to his country. That's as much as it sticks out in my mind more than most things. Of course, I remember him as a boy. He loved his mother, and his mother loved him and his brother. It's hard at times, but it broke his mother's heart.
The struggle for Irish freedom has been long and painful, and the people of Clonard willingly took part in that struggle. The Clonard Memorial Garden opened in August 2000 as a tribute to our fallen dead and a lasting acknowledgement to the relentless will of the people. Without the people, the IRA would never have been able to effect its campaign against the oppressor. As we empower a new generation, let us not forget you, the families. You have suffered many years with the hurt, free from the acknowledgement of your own bravery, but for your own community. We thank you and dedicate this to you.